This morning, as we get started, I just want to express that I heard a story, and this one kind of struck me. In fact, the story was about Stuart Briscoe. How many of y'all are familiar with Stuart Briscoe? Most of you should be, because he's just down the road in Milwaukee. He'd been pastor of Elmbrook Church for just a relatively short time, and somebody came to him and asked, "Pastor Briscoe, would you explain to me this particular passage of Scripture?" And he looked at this individual and said, "No, I won't." "Whoa! Why not?" He says, "I'm not going to explain the Scripture." He says, "What I'd like to do is I want to explain to you how it is you can figure out how to understand that Scripture for yourself." He wanted to equip this person for ministry. And I confess to you, every Sunday morning, I'm not necessarily showing you how to understand the Scriptures for yourselves as much as I'm telling you what I think the Scriptures express. But one of the key areas of ministry that every church needs to be involved in doing is equipping the saints. Making it so that each person that attends the church can do the work of the ministry in the world around them. That's an essential. And as we think of being equipped, how would you feel if there was a fire in your home and the fire department came running up and they said, "Okay, where's the hoses? Where are all the things we would need to spray the fire or to put out the fire?" If they're not properly equipped, you say, "Wait a minute, now there's something wrong." And I think sadly, many people in many churches are ill-equipped. They aren't ready to do the work of the ministry. I'm not suggesting that that's the problem here. I'm not saying that at all, but yet as I look in the Scriptures, I have to confess to you that there's an admonition in Ephesians chapter 4, where we've been looking, where we started looking last week, where we're looking today, that expresses the absolute necessity for equipping. And we're going to look at that today. Now, where are we as far as this series of messages is concerned? Three messages that I'm doing, a message the following week that Galen is going to preach. And it's all focused in on what we call beyond the basics, the benefits of our growth groups. This morning I'm not going to talk a lot about growth groups. I'm going to talk about the benefits of equipping that relates to growth groups. But three studies that we're doing from this section of Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. And essentially what this is trying to emphasize for us would be what I'd call the priorities, the participation that we all need to be doing, and the pursuits that are related to our growth and our godliness. Now today, it's from chapter 4, verses 7 through 13. We'll read those in just a moment. But the idea that I want to start with is the fact that being equipped for ministry means being equipped for life. And I know I attended grad school. I went to Dallas Seminary, and I was equipped for pastoral ministry there. But one of the things that was implanted in our lives, in our minds, in our hearts throughout that time was, as you go out and serve in churches or in mission fields or other places, one of your number one roles is going to be to help people become equipped, not just for ministry, but equipped for life in a culture that's going to run counter to what everything that the Scriptures say. Now this passage of Scripture, as we look at it, here it is. Ephesians 4, I hope you've got your Bibles open. I hope you've got something there to write with your, for the notes or whatever else. But as we look at this passage, Paul writes and says, "But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, He led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Now this expression, he ascended, what does it mean? Except that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth. He who descended is himself also he who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. Verse 11, and he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers. What was it for? Verse 12, for the equipping of the saints for the work of service, for the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature that belongs to the fullness of Christ. Now, that's the passage. Those are the verses we're considering this morning. Those last couple of verses, we're going to look at those next week as well. But as we consider, what is the central idea? What is the main thought that I want to communicate this morning? That main idea basically is that God does three things for us. God enables us, God equips us, and then this last thing is interesting, God expects. And what does He expect? He expects that each one of us, that each one of us to be involved in ministry. We are not saved to be spectators. We're not saved merely to come and listen to a sermon on a Sunday morning and go out and do our thing for the rest of the week and say, okay, next Sunday I'll be back. God has expressed throughout the New Testament, especially in the Apostle Paul's writings, that those that are saved in order to serve. And yes, we look forward to heaven, but we've got responsibility here on earth. And God wants us to know that He will enable us. And He does through the Holy Spirit. God will equip us. That's the ministry of the local church. And because of that, God expects every one of us to be looking around and saying, what ministry can I do? What are the things where I can be involved? How can I further the message of the gospel? How can I encourage people and help people to find the peace of Jesus Christ? And God expects all of us to be involved in that. But in order to do that, what He does is He gives us His Word, He gives us His Spirit, both to equip and to enable us. But now there's one last E word that we need to consider. Therefore, we're without excuse. We're without excuse. And as I look and see the statistics that indicate that church memberships are shrinking, church attendance is decreasing, and the impact of the church in our culture is on a downward trend, I'd say, wait a minute now, there's a problem here. The problem is if we're all to be involved in ministry, if we're all to be equipped, if we're all enabled by the Spirit, if we're all expected by God to be involved in ministry, why is the influence decreasing? Why is it not growing and extending? And I see this passage, and in a sense, this is the only downside that I'm going to communicate this morning. This is the only less than positive thought. We're without excuse. We can't stand before God and say, well, I didn't know. We can't stand before God and say, well, I didn't have what I needed. I've had people come to my office, not here. I've yet had that one here. And I'm not saying it won't happen, I'm saying it will. But I've had people in other churches where I've pastored come to my office and say, you know, Pastor Greg, I don't know. If someone at my workplace were to ask me about my faith, I don't know what I'd say. I don't know how to share the gospel. And I said, one person in particular, he was a man that was a hotel manager. And I said to him, I said, well, now, I'll show you. He says, I'm afraid. I'm scared. I'll show you. He resisted. He resisted. I've had others say to me, well, I'm fearful that my life doesn't show enough of Christ for me to be able to share Christ with people, because they're going to look at me and say, well, you're a mess. Simple truth is, as I look at this passage in Ephesians 4, we're without excuse. So now, as we move forward, as we look and see where we're headed for this coming week, I first want to take a peek back and check our context. Consider what we covered last week, just very brief, very quickly. What we saw last week was that unity in the church involves two things. It involves diligence and it involves discernment. Every one of us is called by God to pursue and preserve unity in the church. It says in Romans 12 that as far as it depends on us, we should be at peace with everyone. We need to pursue unity. We need to preserve unity as much as we can. But now as I say that, it requires diligence. It requires making a determined and decisive effort to pursue and preserve unity among followers of Christ. We need to be giving that determined effort. It says in the passage in Ephesians 4, be diligent to pursue unity. Be diligent to preserve unity, it says. And there's diligence required. But secondly, there's discernment. Discernment. We need to know when and where to draw the line between what is obedience and what is optional. The obedience are the principles that God gives us. These are things, they're mandates, they're requirements. I have to do this. And therefore, there are times when unity is going to be very difficult because we're going to have to agree to disagree with some folks because they're not going to buy our values. At least not until they trust Christ as Lord and Savior are they going to see our values as important. So therefore, we need to have that sense of diligence as I'm going to do everything I can to be unified. But then we need to be discerning and saying, okay, there are times when I have to draw the line and say, no, I can't go your direction. There are other times when things are preferences, when they're options, and we can do that. But it requires diligence and discernment, and that's what we saw last week. But now as we look today, this passage that I just read a few moments ago, what are we finding? We're finding in this passage what I'd call three relevant truths that relate to the practice of ministry. Three relevant truths that we can't get around. And therefore, that's why, as I said a few moments ago, we're without excuse. We have to understand what God does and how God works and what He's doing in the midst of our ministry. And therefore, the first thing that we see is that God presents gifts. He presents gifts to the church that help make ministry possible. Whenever we say, well, I can't do it. In fact, many Sunday mornings, about the third song that Erica does, I'm sitting there and thinking, okay, why am I here? Not the same perspective that she has, or that she expressed this morning, I should say. You know, she's just being blatantly honest about the fact that, hey, as human beings, sometimes we need good reminders. But when I sit there thinking, okay, why am I here? I'm thinking to myself, I can't do this. Now, those of you that know me well, first of all, let me just comment. Throughout school, when I was younger, when I was in high school, I skipped speech class. Why? There's no way anybody was going to get me in front. The only time I was going to be in front of anybody is if I had a ball glove in this hand and a ball in this hand, or a basketball that I was dribbling, or a football that I was catching and running with. I didn't bother me to be in front of people then. You know why? Because I didn't see the people. I was playing the game. And that was fine, but speaking in front of folks, no way. I got to college and I took Speech 101 or 110, whatever it was. There was an optional lab part of that class, or you could take extra tests for the class. Guess what I did? I took the tests. There's no way I was going to stand up and do any speeches in front of people. So therefore, that's one side of me. The other side of me is I have a passion for studying and teaching God's Word. I get excited about this. In fact, I sometimes can't wait for Sunday morning. And Sunday morning comes, and oh boy. Not so much that I'm afraid of being in front of anybody, but I'm thinking, I can't do this without God's help. I can't do this without God empowering what I'm trying to do. It's not possible. So therefore, I see here, God presents gifts to the church that make ministry possible. Every one of us can do what God's asked us to do because God gives us the gifts in order to do it. So we see that. But now, what are we saying? Let me just comment. Ephesians 4 is the most complicated explanation of spiritual gifts in the Bible. And therefore, I'm not even going to start to explain Ephesians 4 and try to explain, you know, Christ came down and he gave gifts. And as it says, he descended, he ascended, all that. It's complicated. And I'm going to simplify it by trying to go to the passages that I think Paul's referring to and explain what's going on there. Number one, there's a promise that Jesus made, John 14 through 16. What's going on there? If we'd have celebrated the Lord's table, we'd have been right in that context this morning. In the upper room, the night before Jesus was betrayed and crucified, that night before, the disciples are sitting there, and at least 11 of the 12 disciples are sitting there biting their fingernails and, he's leaving us! Our friend is going to be gone! And Jesus says, don't be troubled, don't worry, don't get all upset. You believe in God? Believe also in me. And believe this truth, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. And behold, I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, you may be also. And the disciples say, okay, that sounds good. But then he says, but time out, guys. I want you to understand, it's not going to be immediate. And he goes on and he says in chapter 14, around verse 26 or 27, he says, you know, he says, when I go, I won't leave you as orphans. I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm not going to leave you stranded. In fact, I'm going to send you the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, and he's going to come in a brand new way, a way in which he's never come before. The Holy Spirit's going to come and he's going to not only be around you like he is right now, he's going to become a resident in your life. He's going to take residence inside of you. The Holy Spirit's going to indwell you and he's going to be with you forever. And then if we read the rest of the upper room discussions of Jesus and the disciples, he went through lots of different topics. We get to chapter 16 and he says, okay, by the way, guys, I want you to know something. It is better that I go away and that the Spirit comes to lead and guide you. That's to your advantage. That's a blessing. That's a positive, he says. So Jesus made a promise and said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit and he's going to live inside of you and he's coming in a different way than he's ever come before. So that's the first thing that we find there, and I think Paul's referring to that. Secondly, we have provision from the Holy Spirit. Chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, where Paul writes and says, now there are varieties of gifts, same Spirit, one Holy Spirit, many gifts, one Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you and he's giving you gifts. He's giving you the advantages of helping for ministry. He's now there are varieties of ministries and the same Lord. Many gifts, one Holy Spirit. Many different ministries, one Lord that they serve. He's now there are a variety of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. Now he says, but to each one is given the demonstration of the Spirit, what? For the advantage of, of everyone in the church. Spiritual gifts are not to the advantage of one person to say, okay, look at me, look how I can do this or how I can do that. It's for the advantage of the entire body. And there's provision from the Holy Spirit through the ministry of spiritual gifts. Now, secondly, we look at 1 Corinthians 12 again. He says, but one and the same Spirit works all these things. How? Distributing to each one individually, just as God wills. I hated to stand in front of people and talk, but then God gave me this gift. And some people may dispute it. I think it's been affirmed to me through many years of ministry that He gave me this responsibility and this enablement to say, okay, you're going to teach God's Word. You're going to try to explain the truth of Scripture to people, and you're going to try to do it in an understandable fashion. And that's what God's will was for me. He says, you're not going to be able to hide in speech class anymore. Now, to each one of you, God has given specific gifts. And it's according to His will that He gives it. And God's Spirit enables each and every follower of Christ to fulfill the ministry that God has given, that God desires to be done. So there's the provision from the Holy Spirit. Now, one other passage from spiritual gifts, from Romans 12. For just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, we don't all do the same things, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. What's he saying there? Spiritual gifts are intended to benefit the church. And we should look at the spiritual giftings, we should look at all of this from a group perspective, not individual. Spiritual gifts benefit the entire body of Christ. And as we consider that, that's the last point that I want to say in this first section here. There is the benefit and the blessing for the entire church. Spiritual gifts are those provisions of power which enable us to complete the roles God calls us to fulfill as members of His body. He gives us the benefit and the blessing for the entire church, as each one of us individually fulfills the roles that God's given us by using the gifts that we have. And I think it's vital that we realize that God has gifted every person that knows Christ as Lord and Savior. All of us are gifted. All of us have a role and a responsibility to fulfill. So what do we say here? God presents gifts to the church that make ministry possible. Secondly, God provides godly leaders to the church to make ministry personal. To make ministry personal. God provides leaders, people like me, people like our elders, people like those that are involved in organizing certain aspects of ministry, the team leaders or whatever else. God provides godly leaders to the church to make ministry personal. And I'm just going to say right now, I don't even remember what the next slide is. I can't see it on my notes because I've got to turn the page. Ministry is all about people. Yes, ministry is for God's glory. But it's all about people. And God has given godly leaders to the church in order to make ministry personal so that we all can recognize that there are responsibilities that we fulfill. Now, so look at the next slide. What does God do? God empowers and enables people to do the work of ministry. God empowers and enables people to do the work of ministry. God is a sovereign God, and He's capable of doing anything He well pleases, except anything that would be sinful. Bottom line truth is God doesn't need us to accomplish what He needs to accomplish. But He gives us the privilege, He gives us the opportunity to be involved in ministry. And in order to do that, He empowers and enables us to do what we call the work of ministry. What's ministry? Oops. Ministry is, and this is a textbook definition. But I took out some of the words that I never use, and I tried to make them more understandable, but literally, ministry is an activity carried out by those who faithfully follow Christ. And the purpose is to express and to spread the message and the influence of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Ministry is the activity that is carried out by all of us who follow Christ as Lord and Savior. And it's an activity that is designed to express what our faith is to the world, to demonstrate to the world what our faith is. It's also in order to spread the message, to spread the influence of what Christ does in a life. And as I said a few moments ago, ministry revolves around people. You and me. Now, we look at this and we see first that God empowers and enables people to do the work of ministry. Well, ministry involves God working through people to accomplish what He wants to accomplish. Now, if you look at that the way I look at it, I'd say, okay, there's a wild card there. And that wild card is, God is entrusting me to do what He wants? Wait a minute now. That requires me to say, okay, God, I'm willing to take what You offer me. I'm willing to take the enablement that the Holy Spirit brings to my life. And I'll try. But the question is, how many of us are saying, okay, God, I'll try? How many of us are saying, God, I'll get involved? That's the question that is the variable that sometimes makes us stand back and say, look at how the spiral is going downward. There aren't enough of us that are involved in the ministries that God has called us to be doing. Ministry involves God working through us to accomplish His will. Secondly, ministry involves God working through people to touch the lives of other people. We are involved in touching lives of other people. We're involved in trying to spread the message of Jesus Christ. We're involved in trying to express the message in a personal way to people around us. We're called to be attractive to the world, and that doesn't mean physical beauty. That means spiritual expression. And the thing is ministry involves God working through us to touch the lives of other people. It's people to people. People to people. And what's the passage say? And He gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers. What? For the equipping of the saints. People to people. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, ministry involves God working through people to touch. That means teach, train, and transform groups of people. Examples: church worship services, group Bible studies, seminars and conferences that we might attend or we might have. It involves media ministries, people to people, groups to groups. But now let's water it down a little bit, or let's bring it down a little bit farther. Not water it, but, you know, bring it more personal. That's what I want to say. Bring it more personal because it's person to person. Ministry involves God working through individual people to touch, that's to teach, to train, and transform other individual people. Ministry is personal. Ministry means you and me, you and I, to say it in correct grammar, going out and making a difference for Jesus. So it's people to people, it's group ministry, it's person to person, it's individual ministry. Examples of person to person is personal discipleship and mentoring, counseling, encouragement, or service to help or provide for specific needs and concerns that people have. That's ministry. And as we consider what he's telling us in this passage, what we learned in that first idea that God's given gifts to the church to make ministry possible, we've got to tie that back to this and say it's by the power of his presence in our lives. It's by the power of his presence in our lives, with the help of the Holy Spirit, God uses godly leaders to help prepare other followers of Christ for ministry. God uses Sunday morning worship services to help prepare the rest of us for ministry. God uses Monday night ladies' Bible study, Monday night other Bible study that can be done, Wednesday night Awana, Wednesday morning men's fraternity, Tuesday morning women's Bible study, other opportunities throughout the week. God uses those activities that we carry out to faithfully follow Christ with the purpose of expressing or spreading the message and influence of our faith in the Lord Jesus. And all told, as God provides godly leaders to the church to make ministry personal, because it's all about people. Third relevant truth: God's plan for the church. God's plan for the church. Everyone. Me, you, the person sitting next to you, those that are off on Labor Day weekend activities, everyone should be equipped for effective ministry. That's God's plan. And when you look at God's plan, you have to admit that it's ingenious, because God has this multiplication process that says, if each of us touches a few lives of people around us, we're going to reach the world. If each of us touch a few lives and express the truth of God's gospel, of his love, of his grace, of his mercy, if each of us provide encouragement or service or help to people around us, and we all do our part, this plan is ingenious because it reaches the world for Christ. But the key is, are we like the firemen that are going to the house with the fire and saying, can we borrow your hose? It doesn't work that way. God says, hey, in part of my ingenious plan, everyone should be equipped. Now, as we look at this, let's look at the passage once again. God's plan for the church says very clearly, he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of service, for the building up of the body of Christ. And what jumps out at me in that verse is that everyone participates in ministry. And if we look at church history, we'll find that for so long, the church wasn't operating in the sense that everybody went out and did ministry. That's why the Reformation took place, for one thing. And then there are other aspects as we look at church history and realize there are so many times when only a few were participating in ministry. So now as we consider how this all fits together, we realize first off that everyone is enabled by God's Spirit. Everyone is enabled by God's Spirit. Everyone should be equipped for the work of ministry because God's Spirit enables us. But you know what? There's that second point that I made there. God gave the church godly leaders in order to make ministry personal. It's not such that God says, okay, I'm going to zap them and they'll be automatically ready. No, God says, I'm going to add this personal aspect to it that says, people are going to equip people. Individual persons are going to equip individual persons. And what's equipping? Three definitions here. Equipping is to adequately, and this is from the Greek language, this is what that word means. Equipping is to adequately prepare someone for a specific purpose. There are times in equipping where we need to say, okay, I see aspects of gifting in your life that says you should be teaching young people. Or I see aspects of giftings in your life that says you should be organizing these ministries. I see aspects of gifts in your life that says you should be doing this or doing that. And we begin to adequately prepare someone for a specific purpose. That's equipping. Secondly, it's to furnish what is necessary for the task to be done. To furnish what is necessary for the task to be done. And that's all included in the term that Paul uses there in Ephesians chapter 4. Or thirdly, to sufficiently make someone ready for the role that they've been given. And you know what I find to be interesting? What we usually do, we're going to recruit some teachers here. We're going to recruit some Sunday. And this isn't necessarily here. Let me just say, this is what I see in most every church imaginable. It's not what I was taught in seminary. In fact, what I was taught in seminary, most people would say, hey, oh, wait a minute, no, I don't want that. Because oftentimes, before you send somebody out to teach, before you send somebody out to do ministry, you take and you build into their lives for literally weeks before you have them do it. But as we recruit teachers, as we recruit people, we say, you know what? The curriculum's all made up and you don't have much time to put into it. It's no big deal. You can do this. What a mistake. First of all, it's not completely true. Secondly, equipping is to sufficiently make someone ready for the role they've been given. And I admit to you, I'm shooting myself in the foot when I say that because I'm responsible sometimes for the lack of equipping that goes on in our ministry. And yet, equipping is to adequately prepare, to furnish what is necessary, and to sufficiently make someone ready for the role they've been given. Now, with equipping, there is what I call participation or preparation and perspective. Preparation and perspective. Because equipping is an intentional effort by church leaders to help the rest of the church become appropriately and adequately prepared to participate in the ministries of the church by using their gifts and their talents. Let me say that again because that's a mouthful, but it's important. Equipping is an intentional effort by church leaders to help the rest of the church become appropriately and adequately prepared to participate in the ministries of the church by using their gifts and their talents. That's preparation and perspective. Preparing because you want to help them get ready. Perspective is, hey, I see giftings in you. I see abilities in you. I see talents in you. You need to use those. Or secondly, it's to furnish teaching and training that will make the rest of the church ready for the role and responsibilities of ministry. One of the reasons why I am so passionate about teaching God's Word on a regular basis, it's obviously not because I love to stand in front of people and talk, but it's because there were professors in seminary that poured into my life and pushed me to the point of recognizing that if you don't prepare people and help people understand the truths of God's Word, so they can communicate that to others, then there's going to be a breakdown in the process. So, what do we need to do? We need to help people find my place in service. Find my place of service. Now, let me just say, this shouldn't be complicated. Shouldn't be complicated at all, but we make it sound complicated. But what is it? It's three steps. First step, I know there's a lot on the page. Don't try to write it all down. Just try to get the gist of it and put down some thoughts if you were taking notes. Look at the Scriptures and notice what God's commanded us to do. How do I find my place in ministry? Okay, what's the Bible tell me I'm supposed to be doing? Well, I'm supposed to be caring for orphans and widows. James 1:27, it tells me I'm to contribute to the needs of the saints. And I'm supposed to practice hospitality. That's in Romans 12. 1 Thessalonians 5 says that I need to admonish the unruly. I need to encourage the faint-hearted. And I need to help the weak. 2 Timothy 2:2 says I need to entrust these, it says, and I'll put in parentheses there, what we've been taught. We need to entrust that to faithful people who will be able to teach others also. Now, that's just a small sampling of the admonitions and the exhortations and the commands that God's given us. It's a small sampling. But we need to look in the Scriptures and notice, what is God telling us to do? Secondly, we need to look for those things that need to be done. Especially those things that our Lord's instructed us to do. We need to look and see what has to be done. Somebody says, okay, I don't have any time. Well, I understand that problem. But yet, when I look at this passage of Scripture, I say, well, there needs to be some sense of priority in our lives that says, I'm going to try to meet the needs. And as we look around for the things that need to be done, we need to be sober and watchful. Watching to see what is it that has to be done. I found it interesting this morning, somebody did something that they thought needed to be done, but actually they undid something I did. I set a table up for the refreshments out in the hallway. I was here earlier, set a table up, get back later, Donna's going to set it up, and as I look, the table's gone. Somebody note, that table's in the way, we got to move it. Good for that. And I'm not pointing fingers at anybody there, I'm saying, you know what? I'm glad you looked to see if there was maybe something that needed to be done. But then as we look and see what the Lord's instructed us, notice this next verse from Philippians chapter 2. He's, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which also was in Christ Jesus. Thirdly, step 3. Pray for wisdom, for guidance, for understanding. And I added the 4 here because, and for opportunities. I want to emphasize, pray for opportunities. Pray for opportunities to minister. Pray for opportunities to do something that will bring honor and glory to God. Comb the scriptures and see what it says. What's God telling us to do? Look around and say, what needs to be done? And oh God, help me find the opportunities, help me see what you've got for me, help me be involved in ministry, help me to be a participant. And that's what's important. Now, what's that saying? Once again, God's plan for the church, everyone, all of us, should be equipped for effective ministry. What's our personal application here today? I'm not even sure. I struggled in writing this because I thought to myself, I've said it. I've said it all the way through. But I'll say it again and I'll try to say it in a little bit different terminology, just a bit of change there. Everyone needs to be equipped for ministry. It should be at the center of everything we do. It should be right at the center of our, you know, some people say, wait a minute, we're wasting our time. No, we're not. We don't want to send firemen out to have to borrow hoses. We need to be equipped for ministry, all of us. It's at the center of everything we do because being equipped is what makes us strong and healthy as a church. Who what? Who effectively answers God's call for ministry. Being equipped is what makes us strong and healthy as a church who effectively answers God's call for ministry. So, one concluding question. Am I taking advantage of the opportunities to be equipped? Am I making time for equipping? Am I making it a priority? Am I ready to go out? If I had to share the gospel with someone this afternoon, could I do it? If there was some particular ministry opportunity that came up this week, would I be prepared for that? Well, we get equipped by attending church. Probably the wrong week to put that up on the screen when it's Labor Day weekend and the people that aren't here don't get a chance to say, hey, you know what, that's part of the equipping process. Through growth groups. Tom said there are more than 3 growth groups in our church, but there are 3 brand new ones that are being set up. 3 brand new growth groups that are being set up. And there may be some trading around of people in other growth groups. I don't know. But growth groups are an equipping opportunity. Thirdly, Bible studies. I hope that the Bible studies we offer are overflowing as equipping opportunities. Finally, fellowship. Just rubbing shoulders with each other. Iron sharpening iron. People encouraging people. Touching lives. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for the truth of your word today. I acknowledge that Well, as I've expressed these truths, I have to hand it over to you. And I have to just ask very simply, dear God, make this a priority in every life. Make this a desire in every life. I pray that we might be literally expanding our equipping opportunities so that we can go out into a world and make a huge difference with the gifts that enable us, with the teaching that equips us, and with the Holy Spirit who goes with us to make a difference in a culture where desperately the message of Christ is needed. Thank you for each individual here today. Thank you for each family. Thank you for all that have come. I pray as you send us out, Father, that we might be willing to pray for opportunities, that we might be watching to see what it is that you'll do to make us useful for your kingdom. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And again, all God's people said, greet your neighbors, greet your friends. Lord bless and have a great week.